Welcome to Church Online. We are glad you're connecting with us today, and we want to remind you this is week number 10. Week number 10 since we started online services. I want to say thank you to everybody that's been connecting with us online. I want to say even a bigger thank you to those of you that have responded to me or to responded to the messages that you've been receiving and God's been speaking to your life. Thank you so much for the encouraging messages you've been sending back. It means a lot to me just to know that God's word is speaking into your life, and we're believing that God will continue to speak to you through his word. We celebrate this Memorial Day weekend in a different fashion, and we want to pause and reflect and remember all of those that gave their life for us so that we can enjoy the freedoms that we do have. And as we open up in prayer right now, I want to invite you there where you're at to pray with me. And I want to encourage you for these next several minutes, 30 minutes or so, to try to stay focused and connected to God as he speaks to us through his word, through media. We thank you for being with us today. Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much today for the opportunity to gather together as a church body. Lord, we're a church body dispersed right now, and we thank you, Father, for pouring out your spirit on us, and we thank you for pouring out your blessings on us, even in these times of crisis and pandemic, and where things have just not appeared as though we want them to and haven't gone as though we want them to. Lord, we recognize your grace and your love to us in the middle of this, and so, Lord, we pray that you continue to speak to our hearts today through your word. Bring encouragement and comfort to everyone out there today that's listening, that needs to be encouraged, needs to be comforted through what they're going through. Minister grace to everyone here. Thank you so much for all the men and women that have sacrificed so greatly so that we can enjoy the freedoms that we do have in our country. We thank you most of all for Jesus that gave his life on the cross so that we could have eternal life. But Lord, I pray you bless every family today of every soldier that has sacrificed greatly and is still sacrificing. Those that are still alive and in active military today, they're still sacrificing. But Lord, those that gave all, Lord, we just pause and reflect, and we thank you for these people. And we pray, God, your blessings on their families, that you would encourage them today. Bless this time together in your word. Bless us as we worship together today, and we'll praise you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Right there where you're at, we want to worship the Lord together where you choose to stand and sing out loud, or you make a melody that will Lord in your heart. We're going to sing together now, and so let's sing and lift up the name of Jesus this morning. God bless you.
Oh, my soul, worship his soul. my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 2,000 years and then forever.
You to join me in God's word right now for our final message in Psalm 23. And so if you'll turn with me to Psalm 23 as we close out Psalm 23 by looking at verse 6. We need to be reminded that we are like sheep. I had somebody text me last week and said, Pastor, if no other reason God created sheep, he created sheep so that we could see what we're like. And we are like sheep, and the Bible likens us to sheep. We all need a shepherd. We are like sheep in that sheep have to be led. Also, sheep are helpless in the face of predators. They are weak and defenseless. Sheep have trouble getting along with other sheep, and so do people. Sheep are totally dependent on the shepherd for their well-being. And I just want to be honest with you. We are totally dependent on God for our well-being. The next breath that you take right now is a gift from God. And we are totally dependent on God for everything about our well-being. Sheep are stubborn and have a tendency to wander away from the shepherd. And I don't know about you, but I can confess stubbornness. And I'm not bragging about it, but stubbornness is something that we all are confronted with, we all wrestle with, and we from time to time have a tendency to stray away from God, and he's our shepherd, and so he lovingly wants to pull us back to himself. So as we begin together in Psalm 23:6, today's message title is Discovering God's Goodness. Discovering God's Goodness. So I want you to look with me. It's Psalm 23, verse 6 in your Bible. The Bible says, Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And so we look at this verse, and I want you to notice right off, I want you to notice the first word in the verse. In most translations, the first word in the verse is the word surely. Surely. David says surely, not maybe, not possibly, not I hope. You see, David is displaying here again, David is displaying his confidence in God. David is not doubting God. It's an undoubting confidence in God. It's an assurance that David has. It's a certainty that David has. He says, surely, surely. You know, it's true about us. Our mood from time to time may shift back and forth. I don't know about you, but I struggle sometimes with moods and mood swings, and sometimes our mood may shift back and forth, but God doesn't. Our minds may change from time to time. We may be double-minded. We may be changing our mind from time to time, but God doesn't change His mind. Our devotion may falter from time to time, but God never falters. He is a sure God. He is a confident God. And David speaks of the confidence he has. What is David confident in? What is it that he's confident in? Well, he says there in verse 6, God's goodness and mercy. God's goodness and mercy. If the Lord is our shepherd who leads the flock, goodness and mercy are the two sheepdogs that guard the rear of the flock. So we notice a sheepdog. If you look up a sheepdog, you find out the sheepdog is a dog that is trained to guard and to herd sheep. They do beautiful work when they go to herd the sheep, and you can watch YouTube videos on sheepdogs herding sheep. But goodness and mercy are two things that God uses to follow us. And that word goodness there, goodness is simply the good things that are pleasant and delightful. Good things that are pleasant and delightful. Because the Lord is a good shepherd, we can rely on the promise of Psalm 34, verse 10. It says, if I seek God, I will not want for any good thing. And God is a good God. God is a good shepherd. Goodness following me. When you see the picture here, that goodness is literally following me wherever I go, doesn't mean only good things will happen to me. And so many people today want to blame God for this happening bad in their life and that happening bad for their life, in their life. And if God was good, then why are these bad things happening to good people? But goodness doesn't mean when it follows us, goodness following us doesn't mean that only good things will happen to us. Good things will come, and you can write this in your notes, good things. What does he mean when he says goodness will follow after me? Good things will come out of my problems and pain as I follow the Lord. So the key here is following God. And I want to make an obvious statement. God's good to those that don't follow Him even. God is good to those that curse His name. God is good to those that don't believe in Him. God is good to you today. Even if you've denied Him, God has been good to you. But good things will come out of my problems and pain as I follow the Lord. Mercy, not only goodness will follow me, but the Bible says mercy will follow me. Mercy, what does that mean? Mercy means loving kindness or steadfast love. Write that down in your notes. Mercy is loving kindness or steadfast love. Mercy means we don't get what we deserve. And that's so critical. We don't get what we do deserve. Somebody says, well, what do we deserve? Well, the truth of the matter is, when Adam and Eve sinned in the garden, the Bible says, when you eat of that fruit, you shall surely die. Well, that was a promise from God, and that was a promise that came to pass. And because all of us are born into this world, we've all sinned. And death has passed upon all men and all women and all teenagers and young people. Death passes upon all of us because all of us have sinned. But the reality behind death is not something that's just physical, but it's also eternal. It's also eternal. But what the mercy of God does, the mercy of God doesn't give us what we do deserve. The mercy of God gives us what we don't deserve. And that's because of his loving kindness or his steadfast love. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son." You see, the mercy in that is that we didn't deserve the sacrifice of Jesus, but God loved you so much, he showed mercy on your behalf and gave Jesus Christ to die on the cross for your sin. We need to remember God's mercy, and we need to thank God for his mercy. Because we fail him oftentimes. We all fail God oftentimes. Many times we fail God. So we need to pause and remember God's mercy and pause and thank him daily for his mercy. Somebody said, "Goodness to supply every want and mercy to forgive every sin." They're following me around. Goodness to supply every want and mercy to forgive every sin. Goodness to provide, mercy to pardon. If that doesn't encourage your faith, notice the phrase again. Notice the phrase again. All the days of my life. Notice that phrase. All the days of my life. Goodness and mercy follow the child of God each and every day. Think of the days that lie ahead. Just think about the days that lie ahead. When we got into 2020, when it was New Year's Eve and New Year's Day 2020, and everybody was talking about new vision for 2020 and a new year, and nobody saw what was happening today. Nobody saw this coming in 2020. What are the things that lie ahead of us? What do you see? Well, we really don't know. You may see marriage in your future. You may see kids in your future. You may be contemplating going to college in the future. Some of our graduates are already enrolled and they're excited about the fall coming up because of college. And you may be buying a house. You may be buying a new car. What do you see in the future, though? No matter what it is that you see in the future, we may not really know what's going to happen. But we do know this. God's goodness and mercy will follow us each and every day of our life. Hallelujah. That's a good news. God is good in the midst of these days. And I want to say it again, because so many people today are wanting to put the negatives on a day that we're living in today, and all the "I can't do this" and "I can't do that" and "we can't do this" and "we can't do that." And listen, God has been good even in the days that we're living in and going through right now. He's providing for us each and every day. He's pardoning our sin each and every day. And here's something else do you think about with God that many people may not think about with God. He leads us. He is our shepherd and he leads us. But this verse also declares he will also follow us. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me. Notice that. Shall follow me. He leads us, but God also follows us. And goodness and mercy following after us really means this, that God is pursuing us, that God is chasing after us. Now I want you to just imagine, if you will, that wherever you're going, God's goodness and mercy is chasing after you. He tracks you down and wins you over. You know what it is? The Bible says in Romans, the goodness of God leads you to repentance. When you really sit down and start thinking about and counting your blessings and counting the good things that God has done for your life, you know what'll really happen? You'll find that God's goodness has been chasing you down every day that you've been alive. Every day that you've been living, God's goodness has been chasing you around. And God's mercy has been tracking you down. And you know what? It's just to prove how good and how loving and how faithful God is to you. And I want to tell you, if it weren't for all the complaining, more people could see the goodness of God and the mercy of God. God, help us and forgive us right now is my prayer of all the complaining and all the griping and all the negative stuff that we say, because God's goodness and mercy is so great to us. The idea that God follows us places emphasizes on this fact. It's God's desire to absolutely grant us the riches of his grace God pursues us in love, and God's goodness and mercy follow after us because God desires to grant us the riches of His grace. He wants to bless your life. He's chasing you around. He's tracking you down. He's pursuing after you. His goodness and His mercy track us down and overtake us with delight. This means that we should leave a trail of goodness and mercy wherever we go. When we think about God's goodness and mercy tracking us down and being there for us and following after us, it means that we should leave the impression of goodness and mercy on the lives of those around us. As a Christian, you should leave your world a little bit better place than it was before you came. You should be leaving God's goodness for others to see. You should be leaving God's mercy for others to see. You should be showing God's mercy and God's goodness to others. Let's look at the last phrase of Psalm 23:6 together now. Notice what it says here. It says, "And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Psalm 48, verse 14 says, "For this is God, our God forever and ever. He will be our guide even to death." Notice in this verse, He is our God forever, but He is our guide only for a lifetime. You see, one day we will no longer need guidance in the way we need it now. How many of you need guidance today? I know I do. And to be honest with you, I need guidance day by day. You say, "Preacher, I know where I'm going in life." Well, there is a way, the Bible says, Proverbs 16:25, that seems right to a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. Listen, we all plan our ways, but the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. We need to be careful when we plan our ways and plan our days, because God gives us guidance, and all of our steps are ordered by Him, and we need guidance from God. Where will you live when you think about this, "I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever"? Where will you live forever? In the house of the Lord, the Bible says. This means our earthly home is short-term housing. Look at your neighbor and say, "Short-term housing." Because no matter how beautiful it is, no matter how perfect you have it, no matter all the honeydews that you checked off, and you know, guys, we got to keep working on those honeydew lists. And I know your honey's looking at you right now with a big smile on her face. Honeydew list. And no matter how many checks you've made on the honeydew list, and you're getting it just like you want it, remember this. Your house, my house on this earth, no matter how we have it set up, it's just short-term housing. This means when you think about our short-term housing in this world, this is not our home. This world is not our home. Our homeland is in heaven. Hallelujah. When I die, things will just get better. They'll just get better, because then I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. When my physical body dies, I know 2 Corinthians 5:1 is true. 2 Corinthians 5:1 says, "I will have an eternal body made by God, not made by human hands." When I die, I'm just gonna change addresses. That's what's gonna happen when I die. One day a little girl asked her mom, "What happens, Mom, when you die?" The mom said, "Remember the other night when you went to sleep on the couch in the living room? And your dad picked you up in his big, strong arms and carried you to your bedroom? You went to sleep in one place and you woke up in another. That's what happens when a Christian dies. You go to sleep in one place and you wake up in another." Can you imagine what it's going to be like when we die and give up this physical life for the eternal, when we go from one place of life to the other, from the temporal to the eternal. Listen, it's going to be glorious. Life is a journey with a final destination. Don't miss the joy of the journey, and don't complain the whole time you're on the journey. Why? Because goodness and mercy are following you around every day of your life, and God's been good to you. Don't miss the joy of the journey for the final destination being the house of the Lord. The final destination is the house of the Lord, but as we're in this temporal place, as we're in this temporary housing, we know God's goodness and mercy follow us everywhere we go. God doesn't make the journey smooth because life is a test. Remember John 16:33. In this world you will have tribulation. In this world you will have temptation. In this world you will have problems. I find it so challenging every time I hear somebody make the comment or make the quote or say, God won't give you more than you can handle. God won't give you more than you can handle. I want to tell you this, I don't believe that quote. I believe God will give us more than we can handle, just to help us understand that we can't handle it, but He's got to handle it. Listen, there may be more things that come in my life that I can't handle, and I've got to say, oh God, I can't, but You can. Amen? In this world, you will have tribulation, you will have temptation, you will have trials. God doesn't make the journey smooth because life is a test. The road to the house of the Lord has bumps and potholes that jolt us and shake us. But I want to tell you, our faith is in Jesus. And when we get to the house of the Lord, we will see that though the path was often rough, it was for our good. He may not do what you want. God may not do everything you want Him to do. I don't know any parent that's ever done what their kid wanted him to do. God may not do what you want Him to do, but I know this about God. He's going to do what's right, and He's always going to do what's best. I believe there was a show back in the, I don't know, maybe 60s. I think it was back when black and white was still on the TV. Most of you kids have tuned me out right now because you didn't even know there was a TV, a such thing as a black and white TV. But there was a show on that called Father Knows Best. I want to declare to you today, that's not a name of a TV show. That is a fact that God Almighty knows best today. He is the Father of forward motion. Not only does God know best, but He's the Father of forward motion. God's got this thing going, and we're moving forward. And listen, there is a destination, and we've got to learn to trust Him, and He's going to get us home. God's good all the time, and all the time, God is good. He's going to get us home. We learn to trust Him day by day until He gets us home, and the trials of the trip will be lost in the joys of the feast. The trials of the trip will be lost in the joy of His presence forever. Listen, we're going home one day, discovering God's goodness. And I want to read it to you again as we close. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. As we close this message out today, you see, there's some that are going to fall asleep and die in this life at the end of their life, and they're going to die here and wake up in the presence of the Lord. And there are others who have been deceived by the devil into thinking maybe they're saved, or they've deceived themselves into thinking they're saved, and they're going to die in this life, and they're going to wake up in torments, separated from God for eternity. But you know what's following and pursuing after you right now? Do you know every time at the end of a message, no matter who is preaching, when they give the opportunity for salvation, do you know what's pursuing after you? Do you know what's chasing after you? Do you know what's running after you? It's God's goodness and God's mercy that says, stop. Quit running away. you are like a sheep too, and you need a shepherd too. And so my encouragement for you today as you listen and you're watching on that device, wherever you're at, whatever you're going through, if you know you need a Savior right now and you don't know Jesus as your Savior, stop and recognize the goodness and the mercy of God for your life right now. And recognize your need to accept Jesus. The three steps that I've shared week after week after week, it's as simple as ABC, accepting Christ. The A stands for admit you're a sinner. Romans 3:10 says, there's none righteous, no, not one. And that's you. You're not righteous. I'm not righteous. As a preacher of the gospel, I've got a coat and tie on right now. That doesn't make me perfect. There's nobody that's perfect. Listen, all of us are sinners in need of a Savior. And you need to admit you're a sinner today. If you come to Christ, you've got to come that way. And secondly, the second letter's B, which stands for believe that Jesus loved you and died for your sin. Romans 5:8 says God demonstrates his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. I tell you, the goodness and mercy of God is chasing after people every single day of their life as they recognize or don't recognize even that he loved them and gave his life for them. Every time you think about what God's done for you, you need to recognize he demonstrated that love so that you could receive salvation. And then C, the C stands for commit your life to Jesus Christ. The Bible says whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And maybe right there for the first time, you've never accepted Christ and you would like to receive Jesus as your Savior right there where you're at. Can we pray together right now? And you can just repeat after me. My prayer won't save you, but your faith in Christ can. You may repeat after me, dear Lord Jesus, I know I'm a sinner, and I know if I die today that I'd go to hell. But Lord, I believe that you love me and you died for me, and you were buried, and on the third day you resurrected. And so, Lord, I receive your gift of eternal life. I commit my life to you today, and I ask you to help me now to live for you. In Jesus' name, amen. We want to congratulate you right now and say the best decision you ever made, you just made. And I want to invite you to text the number that's coming up on the screen right now, and you can reach out to us, and I want to give you a Bible and give you some more information about becoming a Christian and growing in your faith. And I want to challenge our people that are Christians that are listening right now, wherever you're at, wherever you're in church and wherever you're going to church, I want to challenge you right there where you're at. God's goodness and mercy are following after you all the days of your life. And I want to challenge you and I want to encourage you to stop complaining and recognize his goodness and mercy in your life today. He's chasing after you. He's running after you. He's pursuing after you with goodness and mercy, and he loves you today, right there where you're at, right there where you're going through. I want to pray with you and pray for you. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we know your goodness goes before us. Lord, you delight to bless us. You delight to give us the riches of your grace, and you delight to bless us with good things. And God, we thank you that your goodness goes before us and your goodness goes behind us and it's chasing us. Lord, you're a faithful God, and we declare that today. You're a great shepherd. You lead us in the right way, but you also follow after us and pursue us with goodness, and you want to give it to us. And Lord, I just pray, God, that you'd help us to see this. And Lord, also this mercy that follows us around, God, that you don't give us what we do deserve. Lord, help us to remember daily and help us to be thankful daily, because the mercy of God is renewed day by day. Your mercies are new every single day. And God, as we think about this, as we're reminded of this, Lord, let us just pause and give thanksgiving for your goodness and your mercy. But Lord, let us also celebrate that this life is just our temporary living place. God, this is just temporary housing. God, we're moving on to a permanent place where we, as verse number 6 says, we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Lord, let us celebrate this goodness. Let us cherish Psalm 23 and let us live it out. Lord, we thank you for all your faithfulness to us and all your blessings to us and all your goodness to us and all your mercy. Work in our hearts, and we'll praise you for what you do. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to encourage you to continue to give faithfully to the church and continue to pray with us about reopening the church. Pray specifically with me for Austin Gardner, Pastor Austin Gardner, in Alpharetta, Georgia's Vision Baptist Church. He's a leader of the church, but he's also a leader of the missions over there. And a lot of the missionaries that we support at our church, his church has got the mission board that establishes and teaches these missionaries and really is a big influence in their life. And he's got double pneumonia right now. He's still battling COVID. He's still in ICU. And so if you would continue to pray for him, God's working in his life and God's answering prayer, but continue to pray for him. And thank you so much for tuning in today. We're excited to join you in this broadcast today. We want you to continue to be faithful to reading the Word every day. Continue to be praying every day. Check out Unite 714. It's also on our website for the prayer for this week. This is week number 10. Again, we never did anticipate our church being out this long, but we'll continue as long as we're not meeting in person. We'll continue to get these videos out every Sunday and Wednesday. So you continue to pray for us. We'll pray for you. And we're so thankful you partnering with us in prayer and in giving and in fellowship. We love you. God bless you. Until we meet again, we'll see you soon. And keep your eyes on Jesus. Amen.